Greetings. Muslims often misapply the Bible because they do not study it for understanding. In this case, I received a grocery list from a poster named Simuke. Let's look at claim number 2. Matthew 8, 5-12. The centurion himself approaches Jesus to ask to heal his servant. Luke 7, 2-10. The centurion sends elders to do the asking. O Bible, Bible, which part of you is the truth? Presented this way, accepting what the Muslim claims, it can appear to be conflicted. And that is why I formulated rule number 1. Never ever accept what a Muslim claims the Bible says. Look up every verse, read every passage in context. Matthew 8, 5-12, the centurion himself approaches Jesus to ask to heal his servant. Luke 7, 2-10, the centurion sends elders to do the asking. We will see whether these are even significant details to focus on. So what does Luke 7, 2-10 actually say? Luke 7:2, and a centurion's slave, who was highly regarded by him, was sick and about to die. When he heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders asking him, Jesus, to come and save the life of his slave. When they came to Jesus, they earnestly implored him, saying, He is worthy for you to grant this to him, for he loves our nation, and it was he who built us our synagogue. Now Jesus started on his way with them, and when he was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends, saying to him, Lord, do not trouble yourself further, for I am not worthy for you to come under my roof. For this reason I did not even consider myself worthy to come to you, but just say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I am also a man placed under authority, with soldiers under me. And I say to this one, Go, and he goes, and to another, Come, and he comes, and to my slave, Do this, and he does it. Now when Jesus heard this, he marveled at him, and turned and said to the crowd that was following him, I say to you, not even in Israel have I found such great faith. When those men who had been sent returned to the house, they found the slave in good health. And what does Matthew 8, 5-13 actually say? And when Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him imploring him, and saying, Lord, my servant is lying paralyzed at home, fearfully tormented. Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. But the centurion said, Lord, I am not worthy for you to come under my roof, but just say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, with soldiers under me, and I say to this one, Go, and he goes, and to another, Come, and he comes, and to my slave, Do this, and he does it. Now when Jesus heard this, he marveled and said to those who were following, Truly I say to you, I have not found such great faith with anyone in Israel. I say to you that many will come from the east and west, and recline at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of the kingdom will be cast out into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said to the centurion, Go, it shall be done for you as you have believed. And the servant was healed that very moment. Now the argument made in Satan's Jihad against the Word of God is that minor differences in the accounts have some critical meaning. Let's walk through the accounts in parallel and honestly consider if the different details merit such twitterpation. Luke 7:2, and a centurion's slave who was highly regarded by him was sick and about to die. And in Matthew 8:6, and saying, Lord, my servant is lying paralyzed at home, fearfully tormented. Fact 1, this story involves a Roman centurion. Fact 2, this Roman centurion had a servant. Fact 3, the servant was sick, possibly to the point of death. Verse 3, when he heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders asking him to come and save the life of his slave. And when Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him imploring him. Honestly, whenever I deal with this form of childish jihad, I shake my head. because it comes from a place of defensive weakness in Islam. Always remember, Islam has no credentials. And since Islam cannot defend itself, it attacks irrelevant details. When he heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders asking him to come and save the life of his slave. And when Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him imploring him. Is there any functional difference between the centurion going or sending a servant to ask? As we shall see later, no, there is not. The salient point in this event being recorded is that Jesus is made aware of the need of the centurion. When they came to Jesus, they earnestly implored him, saying, "He is worthy for you to grant this to him, for he loves our nation, and it was he who built us our synagogue." This is a detail not recorded in the other rendition. Is this critical to the central topic of the story? Not really, but I can see how an agenda-driven mind might try to twist it. In fact, if Jewish elders were involved, it may bring politics into the situation. But given there is no confirmation, the importance is reduced. Now Jesus started on his way with them, and when he was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends, saying to him, "Lord, do not trouble yourself further, for I am not worthy for you to come under my roof." So, it is communicated that the Roman centurion is aware of Jewish customs, and knows he is considered unclean or unworthy. Matthew 8:8. But the centurion said, "Lord, I am not worthy for you to come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed." In both stories, the Roman centurion humbles himself as unworthy. "For this reason, I did not consider myself worthy to come to you. Lord, I am not worthy for you to come under my roof." I find Luke is self-consistent with the Luke account. The centurion sent because he was unworthy to go to Jesus. Likewise, the sentiments in Matthew are self-consistent. "But just say the word and my servant will be healed." "But just say the word and my servant will be healed." And here we get the central action that is important. The Roman centurion describes authority and how it works. "But just say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man placed under authority with soldiers under me. For I also am a man under authority with soldiers under me. And I say to this one, 'Go,' and he goes, and to another, 'Come,' and he comes, and to my slave, 'Do this,' and he does it. And I say to this one, 'Go,' and he goes, and to another, 'Come,' and he comes, and to my slave, 'Do this,' and he does it." This is the central lesson in this teaching: the authority of the spoken word. The centurion reveals he knows how it works, and the centurion ascribed such authority to Jesus. "But just say the word and my servant will be healed." "But just say the word and my servant will be healed." And the thing that saddens my heart is the blindness that causes Muslims to miss this critical point. Dedication to Islam blinds them from seeing Jesus healed by his command and not by Allah's permission. Now when Jesus heard this, he marveled at him, at the centurion, and turned and said to the crowd that was following him, "I say to you, not even in Israel have I found such great faith." Now when Jesus heard this, he marveled and said to those who were following, "Truly I say to you, I have not found such great faith with anyone in Israel." And that is point two of the lesson. To Jesus, understanding authority equated to having faith. And speaking of this Roman, Jesus said the Roman had great faith, more than Jesus had seen in Israel. When those who had been sent returned to the house, they found the slave in good health. The servant was healed. And Jesus said to the centurion, "Go, it shall be done for you as you have believed." And the servant was healed that very moment. Let me repeat that. The servant was healed. Now, reviewing these two passages, I find the core details are identical. But I also see the peripheral details are not identical. That can easily be called imprecise. But do these minor points change the meaning or the lesson taught? Not in the slightest way. God recognizes faith, and God rewards faith. The heart that stubbornly attacks with Satan's jihad will always find a dirt clod to kick. The honest man learns judgment and the ability to see what matters, and what is a diversion from the core teaching. Now, the thing I find puzzling, and I have given this thought before, how can I prove that this level of detailed difference is not intentional by God? Just like teaching in parables. Jesus explained why he taught in parables. Luke 8:10, "To you, but to others I speak in parables, so that though seeing they may not see, though hearing they may not understand." The undeniable implication is Jesus is hiding the truth from some who heard it. Matthew 13:10, "Then the disciples came to Jesus and asked, 'Why do you speak to the people in parables?' He replied, 'The knowledge of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him.'" That is an even clearer statement. It intentionally confuses some. This is why I speak to them in parables. And I wonder, does God cause details to be imprecise just to leave breadcrumbs for people waging Satan's jihad of deception, to deceive themselves with their stubborn hard-heartedness? I cannot rule this out given other such scriptures. The strong delusion, for example. 2 Thessalonians 2:11, "For this reason God will send upon them a deluding influence, or strong delusion, so that they will believe what is false, in order that they all may be judged who did not believe the truth, but took pleasure in wickedness." When Muslims have no desire for the truth, for honest study and consideration, is it possible the details are there to delude them and confuse them, so that, like parables, whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him? All I know is that I never want to harden my heart against the truth. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.